As we continue with this instruction, there are a few more points that we will mention to you. Making the best decision for the particular situation you are in at that moment is the single most important thing you can do to ensure you are continually playing great poker. By continually making the best decisions, you will ensure that you are playing winning poker, and over the long run, that is what makes a winner. A great player is patient and waits for good situations. Poker is a game of situations, and you want to be involved in hands in which you have an advantage. You also want to be involved in hands against players whom you believe you can create favorable situations for yourself. We will talk more about these skills in this material. It is important to mention them now so it is in your mind and you begin to think about them as you study the lesson. Now let's discuss some attributes which are necessary to have in order to be a successful poker player. The first one is patience. This is arguably the number one attribute needed by a poker player. Waiting for a playable hand in a favorable situation requires patience. Many mistakes players make in tournaments is they get impatient and play less than premium hands and they lose to better hands. They flop top pair, but their opponent's kicker is better and they lose a big pot. Always start out playing tight in a tournament and focus on learning everything you can from your opponents. Later, once you have started to pick up tells on your opponents and are aware of their style of play, then start making moves on them. Also, there is little reward early on in a tournament when you make a move on an opponent because the blinds are small. Rather, wait until the blinds are bigger and there is reward for your risk as the situation permits. Then try to steal some blinds and pots. By playing tight early on, people will tend to think you are a tight player. Later, switch gears and you will see that people will give you credit for having a hand since they think you are tight and will not challenge you unless they have a premium hand. The next attribute we cover is selective aggressiveness. Don't play a lot of hands with less than premium cards. Play decent hands, and when you play them, be aggressive. Good players constantly put pressure on their opponents. Pressure, pressure, pressure. Be a better, not a caller. Approximately 4 out of 5 times a good player opens up betting into a pot, this player should be raising 3 to 4 times the big blind. Do not enter a pot just calling because you get no information on your opponent's strength. If 4 or 5 people limp into a pot, any hand can win and you are just asking for trouble. Many would have entered the pot for the pot odds they were getting and could have anything for a hand. The more hands out there, the less likely you will win. Bet out to limit the field so you have a better idea where you stand with your opponents. Players give you information when they respond to your bet. If they fold, they were weak. If they call, they may have a hand which they believe might be a winner depending on what comes out on the flop. And if they re-raise, it is probable they have a premium hand. If they re-raise you and they have not been getting out of line playing a lot of hands and or raising a lot, give them the benefit of the doubt, fold your less than premium hand. If they are making a move, they will most likely do it too many times and this will become apparent. So many players will call a re-raise with a less than premium hand heads up and they will be behind most of the time. In the long run, this is a losing situation. You should seldom call a raiser unless you are getting the odds to do it or you are slow playing. Unless you are getting the pot odds to call, one should either re-raise if you think they are making a move or let the hand go if you think you are beat. Again, I want to say this because this is important and will make you money in the long run. If your opponent re-raises you and they haven't been getting out of line, give them credit for a premium hand and fold. Most people know how to play poker. The difference between them and the best players is the best know how to target and get chips out of opponents, and they know which hands and situations to get away from. Being observant at the poker table is another important attribute of a great poker player. Observation is a skill which can be learned and improved upon with the proper training. The best poker players, over years of observing players, have developed keen observation skills. Other professions require people to develop precise observational skills in order to be proficient in their field. For instance, soldiers in Iraq and Afghanistan are required to conduct combat patrols through urban areas where any type of threat can be positioned on any rooftop, window, corner roadway, or side street. A threat can come from basically anywhere at any moment, and it is imperative that they develop keen observational skills in order to enhance their survivability. These observational skills soldiers develop in the line of duty will pay dividends at the poker table. Always be observing what people are doing when they are in a hand, even if you're not involved in the hand. A player with good reading abilities will get most of their information on opponents while watching their opponents play while they aren't even involved in the hand. They observe the hand from beginning to end and see what their opponent's hand was when they showed it down at the end of play. Then the good player goes back through the history of the hand, how it was played out after each card was laid down. He now knows how his opponent's played, with what type of hand, and is gaining some valuable information. Since poker is a game of imperfect information, the more information you have on an opponent, the more of an advantage you can have against them. TJ Cloutier says, "A tiger seldom changes his stripes." This is true. You observe the play of an opponent at the table, it is very likely he will do it again. It is so important that a player have heart. You must be courageous when playing. Scared money is dead money. You must be able to make a move if you really feel you have the best hand. Many people have trouble pulling the trigger when they are fairly certain they have the best hand. If this is the case, if you can't make the move when your reads and instincts say so, your game will suffer. Being a student of the game is another important attribute of a great poker player. It is so important that you have a strong desire to improve your game. The best players do. It isn't by accident they are the best in their fields, and I can't emphasize this enough. It is not just enough to study some information and then just go on your merry way playing. You must go back to the instruction continually. Look at what was good and what was bad and so forth. Always study notes, books, talk to friends, analyze your play after the tournament is over, and attend seminars. Seminars can be expensive, but you can clarify questions and you can get feedback immediately. As previously stated, make this game a passion to you and you will advance past others who don't have your desire. The truth is most people out there aren't seriously looking for ways to improve their game. When you play poker, you want to play your A game all the time because as we discussed, when you play, you are forming habits, either good or bad, and this can affect your play. Playing poker correlates with training because you should always be working on your game, your A game, and you should have a goal where you want your poker success to lead you. That is, if you are serious about your poker play. Again, we can take examples from special operations units. These units, when they train hard. They stay focused as they train and they conduct hot washes. A hot wash is like an after-action report. You finish your exercise and you all get together and discuss it. After you finish playing poker, you should analyze your play. Take notes on what was good and bad and how you may be able to do something to make it better. Doing this will speed up your learning curve, it will pay you dividends at the poker table, and it will give you an advantage over most at the poker table because most players out there aren't doing this. In Special Operations Counter-Terrorist units, a soldier is required to be able to shoot fast and accurately while immediately identifying someone who is a threat and who is not a threat in what is usually a confined area like a room or hallway. To be able to shoot with the speed and accuracy needed to accomplish the mission, a soldier is required to practice the necessary shooting skills on almost a daily basis to hone and maintain the skills needed. If not, his level of shooting will diminish rapidly, and these skills are highly perishable. This too is the same in playing poker. The more an individual plays, the better they will become. But if they are applying the lessons explained in this material and they focus on their A game, by doing this, they will see dramatic improvement in their game over time and much faster than someone who is only playing the game. There have been a few articles written on the comparisons between poker strategy and military warfare. Some of these comparisons are obvious, such as how the two strategies are applicable to each other. But what is not so apparent is how the strategies needed to be a world-class poker player are applicable to being a world-class warrior. As we start to cover this information, you should start to see what we are trying to get across to you. We'll cover comparisons between the two, and this should help to reinforce the warrior mentality you want when you sit down at the poker table. The same as with the attributes of a great poker player we just covered. It is important that you take this information here we are about to cover to heart. You should mentally condition and discipline yourself into using them always, and your poker game will have no choice but to improve.